welcome on this nice spring evening. The sun finally did come out, and it's a very pleasant evening, so we're happy to share it with you. Tonight's speaker is Bob Rocha, and Bob is the educational coordinator for the Coalition for Buzzards Bay, and he'll be talking about his interest in bay scallops. Giant bay scallop invades Falmouth. So, Bob?
Are we on, Tim? Okay. Well, first of all, it's actually Rocha, not Rocha, but that happens. That happens all the time anyway. I'm up here tonight to tell you about a very important animal and its relationship with a very important plant as to how they relate to Buzzards Bay. I'm going to give you a 30-second overview on Buzzards Bay, and you'll have to excuse me as I navigate the obstacle course here. For those of you that are not too familiar with the Coalition for Buzzards Bay, we obviously focus our attention on Buzzards Bay, whether it's research, advocacy, education, or conservation. My role, obviously, is education. One of the things that we've done with the help of 300 volunteers in the last 8 years now, water quality monitoring program in about 30 to 32 harbors and coves all the way around the bay. Volunteer done. An hour a week, every week, from May through September, and then a couple of times in July, twice in August, they go out in boats on the docks and check for, and they sample for nutrients, either nitrates, nitrites, phosphates, giving us a real good picture of the health of Buzzards Bay. Normally, I might have the overhead up here so you could see this. I thought we'd do one better. When we're done, get a whole package of these up there. If you want one or two, take them. There's rubber bands. You know, so you don't have to make a sail out of them as you walk out of the building. One of the things that you'll notice as you look on here, right off the coast, in many areas, you know, even including out here in Falmouth, a seafoam green color. That color represents beds of eelgrass. There's quite a bit of it on here. There should be a lot more. We won't get into those details too much, but we'll touch on that. But anyway, let's just say we should see more eelgrass, because if we see more eelgrass, we're going to see a lot more of the bay scallop. And that will be my session on that part of it. Okay. Now, I do not profess to be an expert on bay scallops, but I will confess that I am fascinated by them. And the more that I learn, the more fascinated that I get. Excuse me. The program that we do is called Blue Eyes in Blue Water, and it's geared primarily for grades K through 7. So if I talk to all of you like I'm talking to grades K through 7, don't feel like that I'm talking down to you. That's just what I'm used to. Okay. Bay scallops are born in the months of July and August, sometimes in September. This would be a full-grown adult bay scallop. So I'd like to ask one of the kids here, if that's full-grown, how small do you think they are when they're born? Anyone have a guess?
108 pounds.
Great guess. You know what? As a matter of fact, I probably shouldn't have asked you that because you couldn't show me. Scallops are so small when they're born, you need a microscope to see them. They're microscopic. Microscopic animals and plants are known as plankton. Scallops, when they're born, and by the way, they are not created inside the parent scallop. They are actually created in the water column, and we'll talk about that later too. When they're created, they live as zooplankton, which is the form of animal plankton, and they eat phytoplankton, which happens to be basically plant plankton, also microscopic, you know, one of those things that you need a microscope to see. And maybe if you're lucky, as things grow, you get a real good magnifying glass, you'll be able to see them then. If we have time, we're going to have a little fun with these cards afterwards. Okay. Actually, I think I want to take a step back and Maybe Tracy and Shari, if you could give me a hand here. I'm going to ask for the help. Actually, if you want to give those to the kids, and Shari, I'll give you the pencils to hand out. The kids and I, and any of you older children, if you want to hop in with us, please do. And I'm not sure if this is going to work on here. Let's see. Okay. Well, that's going around. What I like to do with the kids when I begin this program is to have them think about any walk they've ever had to any beach in the bay. Maybe they've only gone in, gotten their ankles wet, they've gone in up to their belly button, going over your head. Maybe you've read some real good books or seen some good articles or videos about the bay. And I'm going to draw on your wealth of knowledge, any and all of you tonight, to help us draw ourselves a little picture. And actually, the piece of scrap paper that I'm giving you obviously has two purposes. One, so you can draw, and the other one, so you can have your own small diagram of the outline of the Buzzards Bay watershed. For the sake of those who may not know, anybody want to give us a quick rendition of what a watershed is? You want to? All right. We've got some bashful kids here tonight. That's okay. Watershed, real fast definition, is a watershed is a body of land that drains all of its water into a final body of water. So all, a little bit of the rain that falls here in Falmouth, everything in Acushnet and Fairhaven and Westport and Dartmouth all ends up draining into Buzzards Bay. So when you go on the highways and you see those signs, you are now entering the Buzzards Bay watershed, you now know that the rain that falls there ends up getting into Buzzards Bay. And of course, on this side of the canal, the soil is so sandy, tends to percolate through, hit the bedrock, and flow that way into the bay. So those of you that have your papers, why don't you hold them this way? It's a little bit easier to do this exercise. Now let's see if this works on the overhead. Give yourself a little bit of room from the bottom and make yourself a line. Doesn't have to be perfectly straight, because after all, when you go for a walk on the beach, nothing there really is perfectly flat, is it? Okay, so those of you that have been to the beach, that read your books and watch your videotapes, what might be some of the things you would expect to see if you took a walk down to Buzzards Bay? What would you expect to see? Seaweed. Excellent. I love it when people start off with the plants. Great. So on your papers, anywhere you want, we're going to put some seaweed on there. Sometimes seaweed will stick to rocks. Well, by the way, this is not an art project, so if your work is better than mine, don't be surprised. Sometimes we see little things like sea lettuce floating in the water. Some of these seaweeds, they may have little air bladders on them. We call that bladder wrack. I used to like that stuff as a kid because it was kind of like squeezing bubble wrap. You go in the water and you pop it. What else we got? Periwinkles, excellent. So maybe you want to put another rock on here, put a couple of little periwinkles on there. Couple of little periwinkles. What else do we have? What else? Crabs, excellent. You want to pick a kind of crab for me? You want me to just draw a... what color jeans do you have on? Blue crab, great idea. Okay, let's draw that blue crab on there. Blue crab kind of spiky over here on the sides, right? Okay, now... Remember, crabs, if you can't remember how many legs they have, go like this. 8 legs, 2 claws, equals 10. What else we got? Hermit crabs. Hermit crabs steal the empty shells of the periwinkles and the conchs and all and the whelks and those things, and they live in there. What else do we need? We're missing a whole lot of stuff. Minnows, sure, lots of little fish. Right. The general amorphous fish shape, you know, the catch-all fish. We have lots of fish, minnows and young bluefish, young bass. Starfish, excellent. Sea stars, good to have those. Although, a lot of you that like to go out there for shellfish don't want to see them. And I still believe there is a law in the books in this state that if you catch a sea star, you are not supposed to throw it back in the water. Throw it above the high tide line. What else? Snails. Besides those periwinkles, we have other things such as channeled whelks. These long, spirally bodies like this. Matter of fact, I happen to have a diagram of a couple of these things. Side by side, look at that. Okay, so you said starfish. Here we go, is our sea star, and I tend to use the word sea star instead of starfish because it really isn't a fish. Sea star and channeled whelk, which of course moves through the water in this direction, running itself on the sandy bottom. Yes, sir? Clams. Thinking about food, aren't you? All right. We got a couple of kinds of clams, don't we? Of course, the smaller ones, the soft-shelled clams, and this is why I had you make that line off the bottom so you give these burrowing animals some room to dig. And the small ones are the soft-shelled clams. Those are the ones you have with your clam boils and steamers. If there's a soft-shelled clam, there must be a hard-shelled clam, also known as quahogs. All right. Let's throw those in there. So chowder, stuffies, yum, yum, yum. Still on the topic of food. What else? Horseshoe crab. What made you think of that? You expect me to draw that, don't you? All right, let's see. How about that? Look at that. Now, I always thought that horseshoe crabs had four eyes. Because there's one here, two over here. And then I was told there's like another eight more underneath. Near the feet, is it more than eight? Or is that some? I just heard that last week. What am I missing? I thought I just saw your hand go up. What am I missing? Oysters. Oh boy. Well, here's a rock. Let's stick a couple of oysters on there. Oysters like to attach themselves to each other, to rocks. You know, those folks that get into the oyster farming business, one of the first things that they have to do is put down some hard places for these young oysters to attach themselves onto. Spider crabs. You don't eat those, do you? You don't eat those, do you? Oh, okay. Yeah. Let's see if I can draw that spider crab. Long, gangly-looking thing. Almost looks like a spider, as a matter of fact. Jumping off the bottom. Dead center. Mussels, of course. We've got to have some mussels on there. Mussels. Interesting little fact about blue mussels. They attach themselves to each other into rocks using a thing called abyssal thread. If you were to take that thread from a blue mussel and get a thread of steel the same size, put it next to it, the blue mussel's thread's five times stronger. Ah, yes. Peanut butter and jellyfish sandwiches. Okay. Put a couple of these in there. See, oh boy, look at that. You say sea worms or seahorse?
Sea worms.
Sea worms, yep. We got some that create little tubes that go in the bottom. We've got some that crawl around. You do have seahorses, too. Oh, boy, let's see if we can draw that one. How's that? We got a few. Yep. Maybe one or two. Oh, here we go. Good luck.
Sand dollars.
Sand dollars. And when you drop them on the ground, they turn into sand quarters, right? No, okay. Let's see if I can draw this. Okay. One, two, three, four, five. Something like that. Sand dollars. Razor clam, huh? Talking food again. Another clam that likes to dig. Okay, we'll take one more and move it along here because we've got a lot of other stuff that we're going to cover. Good. Octopus and?
Blue whale.
Blue whale. I didn't know Buzz's Bay was quite that deep. Did he just say lobster? I thought I just heard him say lobster too. All right, we can try to squeeze that on there. And octopus. Octopus. It's probably not much. You can draw an octopus on there somewhere. And, oh boy. Octopus is supposed to have 8 legs, and they usually don't, latch onto sand dollars like that. And throw a squid in there. Okay. A couple of plants that I'd like to add to this. Right, last one. Rocks. Plenty of rocks, right? Because rocks provide places for a lot of things to attach to. And one plant that we haven't put on here that I hope we find, and maybe you've seen it either in the water or maybe you've seen it washed up on the beach. When it washes up on a beach, it's obviously dead and it's turned brown, and it looks like somebody's pulled apart a cassette tape. This is called eelgrass. This is the plant that I really wanted to bring to focus tonight. So I'm going to stick some eelgrass on here. Just make some nice long strands. Eelgrass sets its roots in the sediments of the bay. Okay. Someone here is feeling really, really left out. Nobody's talked about this one yet. Do you know what that is? A scallop. Yummy, too. Mm. So we're going to put a scallop on here. Now you're going to notice that I'm going to draw it that way. Why do you think I drew it that way? Because it swims. That's right. Scallops swim, and we're going to see that on tape in a few minutes. Okay, so I thank you all for all of your wonderful wealth of information. You helped us. Whoops. Getting ahead of myself. Remember I talked about, I mentioned this one. Where's my other one? You hiding in here. You've got to have a phytoplankton. Got to have some zooplankton, too. Lots of little animal planktons. Now, of course, being as small as they are, they're very hard to draw. And when you do this in a classroom, there's lots of kids and pencils and desks. You can imagine what it sounds like, but you now have my permission to make little dots all over the top of your paper. Okay. And actually, you can make them all the way up and down because plankton gets everywhere. Goes around at the whim of the wave. Can help itself go up and down a little bit, but they're not exactly the strongest swimmers in the world. And let's put a little water surface up there. And what you've all just done is to help me draw a healthy ecosystem. And I say that because we've got a nice variety of things here. It's not just 1,000 slipper shells and a couple of pieces of sea lettuce. It's, for things to be healthy or to be seen as healthy, you have to have a wide variety of things living there. If this was, like for instance, it could be a place where there's thousands and thousands of rats. It's healthy for the rats, but rats can live anywhere. Rats don't make me think of clean things. And when you think about water quality, one of the things you don't want to see a lot of are things like sea lettuce. But if you see stuff like eelgrass, it makes you feel good. As a matter of fact, if you go walking on a beach and you see eelgrass and scallops, it's a safe bet that you can just go jump right in the water there. It's probably pretty clean. Okay, so now let's talk about this one right there. And I want to go all the way back to the very beginning, to when this thing got its start. So I'm going to come. Keep your pencils handy. We're going to do a little bit of drawing here. If anybody that wants it, there's a bunch there. The newsletter that we're giving out is called Buzzwords. This is something that the Coalition for Buzzards Bay makes 2 or 3 times a year with the help of students, and it's done for students. This one I happened to do last April, and it's become part of this program. Later on, if you'd like, we have some of the new issue right here. And when we're done tonight, actually all of these things here are for you to take if you'd like. So this is the new issue here. So as soon as you get your dot to dot, open up to page 3, and we're going to actually, why don't we do this together? And I will only say this, this is not a porcupine or a hedgehog. So,
okay. So if
you'd like to follow along, those of you that aren't quite sure where number one is, number one's right up here.
So it's 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and here's the other tricky one. 7's hiding down here. Then it gets pretty simple.
What do you think about that thing? What you've just drawn is a baby scallop. What did I do with my shell? That's a baby scallop. Now, the thing is, as I said, this is a full-grown adult scallop. This one died of old age at 2.5. Bay scallops live the very oldest to be 2.5. And if you're only going to live to be 2.5 years old, you might as well get your childhood over pretty quickly. So, they are born usually between July, late August, as plankton. 2 weeks, they get to be a kid. They get to go through all these little changes from being a one-celled embryo to going through the stage which is called a veliger. And I'll draw that, I'll write that on here. So, you are now a baby scallop. You are this little microscopic animal swimming through the water. Your shell, after these last few days of this stage, your shell is just starting to form over here. Still pretty soft, doesn't give you a whole lot of protection. You're up in the plankton layer with the other zooplankton and with the phytoplankton, and you're eating phytoplankton. And you're a very hungry little animal. You eat lots and lots of it. Case one, where the water quality has got to be good. If you're a little animal like this, and you're eating phytoplankton, the water's got to be clean for the sun to get through for the phytoplankton to grow. If the phytoplankton doesn't grow, scallops don't eat. The other thing is, if you're this small, you've got a delicate little body without much protection. You don't want to be swimming in oil, antifreeze, any of those things that can wash off the road. You need the water clean. And they especially like to be up near the top where there's a lot of sun getting through. So it's not much to ask for these things to have some clean water for the first 2 weeks of their lives. And besides having to deal with potential pollution, they've also got to deal with getting eaten, including by these little bath toy-like animals known as sea squirts, also called tunicates. Sea squirts are usually about that big, sit on the bottom, and they're little... You can't see that. Okay. And they're very small, usually have a pair of siphons on them. One sucks the water in, filters it out in their bellies, and the other one squirts the water out. I have a 3-year-old daughter who just figured out how to use her squeezy bath toys. It's the same thing. So if you were to pick one up and give it a squeeze, you'd probably get a little bath. So these things love to eat lots of these small, lots of planktonic animals and plants. So, okay, childhood's over now. The 2 weeks is up. Shut that off. It's time to go settle down out of the plankton layer and go hide in the eelgrass. And hold that nice and close. Okay. For the next 4 to 6 weeks, scallops get to be teenagers. And they also get a new lovely name known as spat. Now, if they're coming down here to hide in the eelgrass, what do you think they're hiding from? What are they hiding from? Lots of stuff. Besides those, what else? I've already heard the word out here. It's predators. They're hiding from predators. You remember, it's still a very small animal, barely visible, shell's not hard. They're going to hide, and they're going to settle down at the bottom of the eelgrass blades over here. Eelgrass is the most important species of submerged aquatic vegetation in Buzzards Bay. In other words, of all the plants that set their roots in the bay, the roots stay wet, they're always underwater no matter what the tide is. This is the most important species. It's obviously very important as a food source, but it's eaten more when it's dead than when it's alive. It's because it breaks apart easier. Lots of things like crabs and worms and fish will eat it, filter it in, or do that. And then there are a couple of species of birds that will eat it when it's when it's alive. And of course, as with any plant that sets roots, it helps to keep the dirt from getting washed off. And then of course, it creates lots of oxygen for the things that live in the water. But for the things that have soft bodies and need to hide, this is their hiding place. If the water is polluted, the eelgrass doesn't grow, scallops have nowhere to go. So for this next stage of their life, this has to be there. So 4 to 6 weeks. So now, you've gone through those 2 weeks as a veliger, those 6 weeks as a spat. You can't hide in the eelgrass anymore because you've grown too big to hang out on the blades of grass. How many of you kids climb trees? Why don't you go out to the end of the skinny branches? Why don't you go to the tops of the trees? What happens? What happened to him?
He didn't fall.
What happens? Yeah, exactly. It definitely cannot hold up your weight because it's getting skinnier and skinnier. It's getting weaker. So if you're going up this blade of grass, which is only being held up by the water eventually, maybe your weight's going to pull you over and you end up back down on the mud where you were in the first place. So since scallops don't dig in the mud like clams and quahogs, and they don't attach themselves with Bissell threads like blue mussels do, scallops do something else. And Tim, this is your cue to run the video. So I'm going to sit down and get out of the way so you can see this. And I will confess, these are not bay scallops. These are sea scallops. I don't have any bay scallop video. And this was taken off of Boston and the Stellwagen Bank Marine Sanctuary. So this is not a Pac-Man video. This is the real thing. You see, some of those shells have little hitchhikers on them. Lots of plankton there in the water, too. It's about to end. Okay, Tim, if you want to rewind that and play it again so they can see it. Unfortunately, I only have about 20 seconds of video here. Look how fast they go when they go backwards. This is probably taken in about 80 feet of water. Yeah, these folks were nice enough to give this to us. There's also a lot of video in here of sand lance, lobsters, an angel shark, crabs, sculpin, several things. And you'll notice too that they just do little sprints. They just don't have the strength to do long distance swimming. So they'll sprint out, settle down. And when they sit in the bottom, they keep their shells open. Question in the back, yes sir.
I'd just like to say that bay scallops, when they swim, they go the opposite way. They swim hinge first.
Okay. It's true. So if you think these are long distance sprints, they're definitely short. That's okay, Tim. Thanks. Okay. So it would be real hard for me to bring all of you up here to have a look at this and see the guts on the inside. And since we did promise you that a giant bay scallop would in fact invade Falmouth, I think it's time to take out the scallop. That okay? Okay. So Okay, so there's our giant bay scallop. I'd like to invite those of you that want to come up and have a look to come on up.
Not real.
Oh, it's not real. No. Okay.
It is real.
And I will also hold up all the parts, you know, for those of you that don't want to come down. But if you want to come down, please. Now, I will also ask, because this is the only one of its kind, it does have to be a hands-off kind of thing, which is kind of a bummer. I'm going to talk about all of it. Yeah. Yeah. We're going to do our tour. So I'm going to hold this up for those of you that are in the back. Bay scallop. Of course, it looks like a Ruffles chip. No, you can stay up here. No. It's all right. Yeah, this is a hard hat zone now. Okay. Looks like a Ruffles chip. The reason for that is if you have a nice ridge shell instead of a thick solid shell, you can make the shell strong but light. If this was thick as a quahog shell, it would either not be able to swim or would have to have such a big muscle in there to help it swim, there wouldn't be room for anything else. And of course, they are a bivalve, and as he just reminded us, when they swim, they're going through that way, through the water. But if I showed you they hinge the whole time, you wouldn't be able to see anything. So we're gonna turn it around. Okay. I'm gonna open it up here. Hold this up for those in the back too. Okay. Isn't that beautiful? Okay. Now, I guess we'll work. We'll go from our outside in. Anytime you find a shell on the beach, you know that it was made by the animal that was living in there. Luckily for us, these things don't just fall out of the sky. Otherwise, we'd have a lot more head injuries than we already have. Okay, this part right here is called the mantle, top and bottom. This is what helps the shell grow. Gives off the minerals, makes the shell grow. The next part you'll notice, and if you ever get to see a good picture of a scallop that's sitting on the bottom with the shell open, you'll see all these fringy things hanging down, which is what this is. This is called the vellum. And the vellum is there sort of as a chemical sensor underwater. It's almost like the way we would use our nose on the land, they would use this underwater to be able to sense things coming at them. And I've had more than one kid say that they've been to a place where there was a tank full of scallops and somebody came and put in a sea star. And as soon as they did it, the scallops all began to move around because they could sense that coming. And also, you know, and they're a good filter as well of the things that are going to be making their way in, because of course when they're sitting on the bottom, their shells are open, the water is bringing the food to them. May also bring other things in there like sediment, you know, and those things will help to filter out some of those larger particles. Everybody wants to know what these blue things are, and I bet most of you already know what these blue things are. Do you know what they are? Actually, yours are blue. Mine aren't. Yours are brown. Yours are blue. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Eyes.
Your eyes. That's right. Bay scallops have these beautiful blue eyes. This is not just here for decoration. They are beautiful blue eyes. And the funny thing is, I've been told differing things by differing people. At first, I was told that scallops have between 40 and 70 blue eyes. Then I heard recently it's more like 150 and maybe more. So we're going to go with lots. Okay. Lots of blue eyes. Okay. Let's talk food. Do you know what that is?
Yeah.
What is it?
Scallop.
That's the scallop. This whole thing is the scallop. You know what part that is?
Part.
It is the part we eat. This is the muscle. One of the many significant differences between bay scallops and most other bivalves is that they only have one muscle, adductor muscle. It's a two-in-one muscle. This part right here is the fast muscle. This is the part that opens and closes so the animal can swim. And of course, around the outside, we've got the part that's there to help keep the shell closed. Do me a favor. Make a muscle and hold it tight. Pretend you're mad at me. Hold it. Hold that muscle tight. No, hold it tight. See what he's doing? He had his muscle nice and tight. That's what this thing would do if it thought that a sea star was going to come up here and try to pull its shell open. You'd make a pretty good scallop, you know that? And by the way, scallops, of course, the muscle would be attached here and here, because you cannot go up to a scallop in the wild lift it up so easily and say, peekaboo. You can't do that. It's Velcro. Do they have Velcro in real life? No, of course not. So next time, and one of the things about scallops when it comes to eating, especially the bay scallops, the best time to eat them, beginning of the harvest season, because at that time they're packing on glycogen and other things so they can make it through their winter hibernation, because they will sleep during the winter months. So if you get them at the beginning of the season, which in many places begins mid-October, they've been packing that stuff on, they're nice and sweet. And of course, the bay scallops, you know, they're only about the size of my top knuckle there. The sea scallops are, you know, the big ones we get. And of course, it makes sense, because if you got a scallop that big, you're going to get a big muscle as compared to one that big. Okay. Okay, let's go back inside now. How do fish breathe? From their gills. Scallops do the same thing. Scallops have gills as well. And let's see if we can hold these up here. Actually, I'm going to take one of them right off. Okay. Okay, so now this thing only breathes half as well. This is one of the scallops' gills. They do have two, and they go, you know, they pretty much find their way, you know, around two-thirds of the cavity here. And they have two jobs. Obviously, the one job we all know about is they help the thing breathe, because they get the oxygen out of the water just like your lungs do. But they also do one other thing. And this isn't a very, very technical word, but I like to say they act as a crash pad for the food, because the water's bringing in all that phytoplankton. The gills are nice and sticky, and they have these little cilia on there, which are like kind of like little hairs, and they trap the food with a little bit of mucus. And if you know anything about mucus, you know it's sticky. Well, the gills will grab onto the food, and then like they'll pass it from here to here, and it'll go all the way, and it'll come into the mouth. The mouth is back here. So two-in-one muscle there, two-in-one gills. When you're a small animal, I guess you combine jobs as best you can. So now the food's making its way into the back, and eventually it's going to find its way into the mouth. Well, this is not a mustache. This is actually the mouth. Okay. There's a little opening right there. Okay. And this will be open again, you know, when I'm done. So if you're not getting a good look now, you can come back up. And on the outside of the mouth, and this, you know, not another technical word, you could call these the lips. They're actually called the labial palps. And they're on the outside to also help with the transfer of food. Now, occasionally, scallops will find themselves in water that's been stirred up, is full of a lot of sediment, and it creates a feeding problem for the animal. If there's too much sediment getting in, even if there's food in there, it'll overload the gills. The gills can't handle all that stuff, and it gives off like this mucus rope, which will grab onto the food and the dirt. And this one should actually have a lot more dirt on it, but this is also a nice little demonstration of what the food looks like, and also the attention to detail of the woman who made the scallop. So this rope would actually just fall off the gills and couldn't be processed by the scallop, because it is, you know, too much, and would just get washed right out of the shell. And the mouth over here, where'd the mouth go? Wants to leave. It wants a new job. You know, this part right here, you know, they just can't take in all that stuff, so they're going to make sure that this does not get into the mouth, so it'll wash it away. So that's another reason to keep our water clean and not always getting stirred up. Now, here's a real easy question. Once it goes into the mouth, where's it going to go?
Into the stomach.
Well, here's our scallop stomach. And attached to the stomach is this nice green liver-type gland here, which also gives off lots of digestive acids to help it break down the food. And if you look inside, are these little black holes here, which are ducts, which will release the juices into the stomach. And inside this, because scallops do not have teeth. They don't have brains either, by the way. They have this little ganglia, which kind of, you know, tells it what it has to do. But all these little phytoplankton here that it eats have little shells on them. Well, the scallop's going to be able to get those shells off. But if the scallop doesn't have teeth, it's going to have to find a different way to do it. So with the combination of the acids coming from this gland right here and this thing in the stomach called the style, which
rotates, grinds the plankton against this little shell, this little shield called the gastric shield. It actually will break up the shells and send the juicy plant parts right there into the stomach. So there we go. Okay. What do you think it's going to go next? If it's going to go through the stomach, let me see if I can pull all these out of here. Obviously, it's going to go next through the intestines. And the intestines also act as a conduit for a lot of the other fluids that move through the body. The kidneys here. Let's see. I'm just going to leave all these parts out so you can have a look at them afterwards. Okay. Now, scallops. Scallops are both male and female at the same time. Not that you can tell from the outside, because a shell is a shell. But inside, they have the stuff, they have the parts that will help them, of course, create new generations of scallops. So, male organs here, the female organs here, the intestines help, this tube helps to get all those released into the water. When the temperature's right, and it's also supposed to coincide with a nice bloom of phytoplankton as well, they'll release the male cells first, the sperm into the water, wait a couple of hours, the eggs will go in. This also, obviously, you have to have quite a few of these around, otherwise they're going to self-fertilize. So you hope that there's lots of these base scallops in an area. All this stuff will mix up, and then after the sperm and the egg meet, within about 36 hours, development begins. And last but not least, this is not a hot dog bun. This is the animal's heart right there. Okay, and I will leave all these guts out to look at later on. Oh yeah, and one other little part that I didn't show you. Even though scallops do not dig in the mud like other animals that do, like for instance clams and quahogs and razor clams, and they do that with a muscular foot which has no bones, no toenails, no knuckles. It's just a muscle, kind of like our tongue. Scallops still have their foot. It's still there. They don't use it as far as I know. Kind of like a thing attached to our large intestine called the appendix. Okay. So there's our tour of the scallop. And I thought we'd wrap this up. Perhaps we could have a couple of volunteers here. Oh, yeah. Can't believe I skipped over this. Let's go back to the spat age of the scallop for a minute. Of course, when they're hiding on the eelgrass, seems that the number one thing that they're going to hide from, at least over on the western part of the bay, are things called mud crabs. These little crabs about that big with black-tipped claws. I know out on the Cape, which tends to be the northern limit for the bay scallop, a major problem has been green crabs, which are introduced here about 100 years ago. Although it hasn't been proven conclusively, seems that the number of mud crabs have gone up as the number of tautog has gone down. And tautog, of course, especially the young ones, like to eat the mud crabs. And the tautog numbers have gone down because they've been fished well, because someone came up with a way to get the bones out easier than they had been. And they're a good eating fish, too. I want to play a little game if the kids want to give me a hand. You want to come on up? Perhaps this game can be played without a microphone. Come on over here in front. Okay. Just to wrap up to show how all these things connect to each other. I want to talk a little bit about food chains and food webs. Anybody know where almost all the food webs begin? Or food chains begin? And you can help out here too, and we can get going. You're right, exactly. Food chains is one thing eating another, to pass along the energy. Okay. What did you have for breakfast today? Anybody remember what they had for breakfast? What'd you say? Bread? Banana bread, is that what you said? Banana bread. Yummy.
Banana nut bread. Okay, let's think about that. The banana nut bread. The wheat for the bread comes from a plant, right? What does a plant get its energy from? I'll give you a hint, that big yellow ball in the sky. The sun. Okay, the sun provides all the energy plants need. Sun, water, a little bit of nutrients in the soil help the plants grow. We cut down the wheat. We use it to make your banana nut bread. You have breakfast. Same with the bananas. Bananas come from trees. Trees get their energy from the sun. Anybody have any milk today? Milk comes from cows. What do cows eat?
Grass.
Grass. What does grass eat? It doesn't eat anything, does it? What is it? Well, almost. Yeah. What does it get its energy from? From the sun. Okay. So we're going to begin again with the sun. Who wants to be the sun? Who wants to start us off? You know, you'll be the sun. I'm going to call you Sonny. All right. Where's the end of my rope here? Okay. Why don't you come right out front? Okay, you get to be the sun. Now, I've just given you one of the answers, and think about some of the plants that we've talked about today. This microphone loves me. What might be one of the things that will use the sun to make energy? Do you know? Somebody want to help them out? Eelgrass. Ooh, all right. Here you go. Come right up front. You get to be the eelgrass. Hold that. I want to face the crowd. Nope, face the crowd. One hand on the grass, one hand on the rope. Now think of something that will either eat eelgrass or hide in the eelgrass. Scallops. And I don't have a big poster of scallops, but you, of course, you get to have the hand puppet. You stand out front. We'll give you the rope. Pass it along. Okay, here you go. Let's hold that tight. Now, I just told you about this one too. The scallops that are hiding down there are teenagers right now. Do you remember what eats them? I'll give you a hint. What has little claws? Crabs, close enough. Where did my crab poster go? Is it in here? Here it is. That's not it. It's the bottom. Here it is. Come on out front. Finally, somebody gets to wear something. Hang that around your neck. Okay, hold on to that. Now, can you think of something that might eat a mud crab?
A fish.
What a good guess. Here you go. Come on up front. I'm going to put you over here. You get to be the totog dining on mud crabs. Okay. Now, looks like we're going to have some other people come out of the audience to help us out. Something else that, of course, needs the sun that lives in the water. Who wants to be my phytoplankton? Only one job at a time for you. He's going to be a handful. But do I have to wear it? All right, I'll wear it. Okay, now. Hold that. Okay, now. Now we're starting to get away from food chains and creating food webs here. Now, what eats phytoplankton? We got lots of stuff here. We need more kids. What eats phytoplankton? I don't have any blue whale cards with me, though. But you're right. Whales eat plankton. Anyway, tell you what. I'm going to hang this zooplankton here. And, of course, we could get... But the point of all this, even though, you know, we don't have all of our volunteers here to show us, is that all of this stuff connects to each other in a food web. And if we take care of the resources we have, we won't break all these things up. Because if you begin to break up one, for instance, we had oil on the surface, blocks off the sun coming through, maybe the phytoplankton doesn't grow. It affects the scallop at its first 2 weeks of life. Maybe in the middle, the eelgrass doesn't grow. Well, then the scallop's not going to make it through its spat years. And then, of course, even at the adult age, when the scallops are still eating these, might not make it through those years again. So if we take care of the resources, we can have our scallops. And of course, there's lots of reason to keep our scallops around, not the least of which is the fact that A, they're great to eat. B, economics. You know, when people are out there catching them, there's obviously people catching them. There's at least, you know, if you've got a commercial boat, there's two people on the boat. Someone's going to process them. Someone's going to sell them. Someone may come to the restaurant and order them. Someone's going to take your order. Someone's going to cook them. Someone's going to prep them. You start getting into all these things that keep on fanning out. So there's those benefits there. And the simple thing, I would much rather, and I know all of you, would much rather live in a place that's clean, clean enough to support eelgrass and bay scallops, than a place where these things cannot grow. So I will leave you with that. And for those of you that would like, I have a nice big bag of scallop shells here. Some of them have the remnants of hitchhikers on them, in this case barnacles and worms, and some are just plain empty. And for the adults that would like, we've got our Baywatchers report and some other things there. And any questions? Yes, sir. At the most, 2.5 years. It tends to be about a year and a half. Then they'll just die. Yeah. How they harvested? Three ways, basically. If you're going to do it commercially, you'll have a small dredge, and it's only like that big. It's pretty small. You're going to be in shallow water. You know, you really can't have a big dredge. There's that way. There's probably the most fun way that I can think of. Put on a mask, get in the water, go in there with a net. And then there's also this thing called a view box, which people actually make on their own. It's actually a big tube, plexiglass in the bottom with a little homemade handle, and you hold it over the side of the boat. You look through it, and as they go by, you put a net in the water to catch them. We actually have one in the office. Our shellfish warden let us borrow one. They're going to be where the eelgrass is, and you know the eelgrass is limited by water clarity and then the amounts of nutrients in the water. Yeah, if the water is clean, you know, maybe it'll be 30 feet deep. You know, yeah, but more likely it's more like 6 to 12. You know, from what I've seen. Yeah, like for instance, over on the west side in Fairhaven, there are lots of eelgrass beds there. There's actually a guy with a scallop farm there. It says he grows about 70 million a year. And if you look on the poster here, you know, you've got some, especially over Falmouth here, Gunning Point, Quissett Harbor, all in those areas. And actually, Quissett Harbor, I think in our Baywatchers report, was voted the best water quality in all of Buzzards Bay. That I don't know. And okay. The question was, for those in here, what's the status of the pollutants that have settled into the sediments of New Bedford Harbor? Well, you know what? Before I answer it, we gotta let these kids sit down. Thanks, guys. Good job, kids. I'll deal with that rope later if you want. And then I'll come back and I'll answer your question there. First phase of PCB dredging is done. That was, I think, more than 4,000 parts per million of the PCBs in the sediment were taken out, put in this thing called a confined disposal facility, a CDF, that was sitting in the city. The last truckload just got taken away to an off-site hazardous waste landfill in a town, oddly enough, with the name Model City. And now the next phase is going to take 10 years. They're going to build four more CDFs along the river on the New Bedford side, dredge all these things out down to between 10 to 50 parts per million based on where they are and how close to existing salt marshes they get to, and put them in there. And those things are, you know, they're going to be there forever or until they come up with a technology that can get them out of the water. And oddly enough, one of the things that does a decent job of it are quahogs. They actually, every time they filter a PCB through, they knock off a chlorine atom. The more chlorine atoms there are on a PCB, the more toxic it is. So, and good. Does it dig it up? I would. I know that one of the reasons the season is held off until October is because they usually wait until the eelgrass stops its growing for the year. And these things do bounce along the bottom. They tend not to just scrape, but they bounce. And obviously there'll be some digging up that way. But as far as the details of it, I can't answer this. You know, there's probably people here in the audience that, you know, that could answer it better than I could. Did I answer your question enough about the PCBs? Okay. Yeah. One of the nice things that's happened in New Bedford, but on the other side of the outer harbor and the side that faces Dartmouth, a place called Clark's Cove, with the new wastewater plant that's there, with the there were 14 houses that were tied directly into storm drain lines instead of sewer lines. Every time they flushed, it went right out into the bay. The city went and did dye tests in people's toilets and washing machines and stuff, found out what those were, and put those into the sewer system. And they also stopped the combined sewer overflows from dumping water out on days when it didn't rain. So eelgrass is actually coming back on its own. So now you walk on the beach, you find eelgrass washed up in small scallop to seed size. So. Yeah, it's slowly. In that case, they wouldn't let you eat them, no, definitely not. And you know, it's not being done commercially either, but there is a professor at UMass Dartmouth, he and one of his grad students, they're actually doing that. You know, they've been looking into this to see what bivalves could actually do this process. And they find that quahogs are better at it than oysters. Oysters do it slowly. Yes.
So a valve is not like
Right. Oh, that, well, it is in different terminology.
Yes. Yeah.
But in this case, you know, a bivalve animal has two shells. And a univalve has one. It has nothing to do with the ability.
Starting, stopping, flow.
No. I don't know. You know, maybe it does in that case, but in this, it just means shell. Yeah. Any other questions? Yeah. And not offshore, but off-site. Yeah, it is. It certainly is. It's far from the best answer, but you're right. It is. It just becomes, you know, someone else's problem. But they seem willing to. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right. Can't argue with that. No.
Is that off-site still the water, or is it?
I don't know. I don't know anything about Model City, New York.
New York?
Yeah. Yeah, that's all I know about it. It's a hazardous waste line landfill. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's all I know about it. But still, it's now, you know, it's somebody else's problem. PCBs do not dissolve in water. They actually settle out. Which is why they're almost, you know, they're all in the dirts there in the Acushnet River. No, thank you very much. Oh, sorry, hang up.
Can you tell me anything about the little crabs that you find in the
scallops? Oh, sure. What I know, yeah. Scallops, mussels, all a lot of other bivalves will often have this little crab in them called a pea crab. And it's, and you know, from what I've heard and read, it's just a hitchhiker. It's just there to live inside and get some free food. Doesn't seem to have any effect on the animal. Because if you eat a bivalve without washing it well, you may end up with an extra crunch or two in your mouth because you end up eating the pea crab. There is this animal called Bunia seminuta, which makes a little tube on here and then will stick its nose, you know, its proboscis over the edge and begin to suck on the blood of the scallop. So those are, you know, two things that I know about. And I don't think these little hitchhikers here do anything, you know, other than maybe slow down the animal a little bit with the weight that they add. You know, the barnacle and the worms here in these tubes. And getting back to harvesting, whenever you harvest the scallop, the one thing, you don't measure it by size, you look for a growth ring. If they're born in July and August, hibernate through the winter. When they wake up again, they're obviously going to be eating to get ready to reproduce, and then if you know they're not caught until the following October, they've had at least one chance to breed.
And of course, at that point, you'll see a growth ring on the animal, just like you'd see a growth ring on a tree, where the growth from 1 year stopped and then the new growth started. Yeah. So if you want to grab, you know, one of these, you might be able to see. You can see it really well on this one because it's been cleaned up and varnished and everything else. Yeah. So you can, I'll leave this here to have a, you know, have a look at. So, you know, feel free to take anything over there, have a look at all this stuff. Thank you.